very warm welcome to Bharata First. You're watching Big Picture with me, Frank Razan Pereira. And since you're here, I would like to thank you for your continued support. For those of you who haven't already subscribed, please like the video, subscribe, hit the bell icon, and then all notifications. Do follow our social media handles for all the latest updates, and you can also subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive content. The Bharata First team runs a daily Big Picture quiz. Please do participate by going through the description in the Big Picture videos. Here are the UPI IDs for those of you who would like to come forward and contribute. A small contribution that you make will be a giant leap for us to keep bringing you this content. So do continue to show your love and support. All the information is in the description of this video, so please go through it. Now to the discussion. India's prisons are overcrowded with nearly 70% under trial prisoners. A large number are languishing in prisons without quality legal aid and lack of family support. As per Prison Statistics India report 2019, there were 4,78,000 inmates in around 1,300 prisons in the country. Most of these prisoners hail from economically poor backgrounds. When the COVID-19 pandemic struck last year, COVID-19 positive cases in prisons became a cause for worry. Same is the case in 2021 as well. The Supreme Court took suo motu notice of the situation in the prisons and passed several significant orders, which led to the constitution of high-powered committees at the state level, headed by the chairperson of the State Legal Services Authority, to decide on categories of prisoners who could be released on temporary bail and parole to reduce overcrowding of prisons. The Jammu and Kashmir High Court on Monday decided to release jail inmates in the Union Territory on 90 days interim bail, in view of the Supreme Court directions. Other states are also looking into this matter. In this edition of Big Picture, we will analyze the need for prison reforms. Joining me on the program today are S.P. Vaid, former Director General of Police, Jammu and Kashmir, and Vipul Mudgal, Director, Common Cause. Thank you to my guests for joining me on this edition of Big Picture. Mr. Vaid, let me start the program with you first. Let's first try and understand and analyze, why do we need prison reforms? Why is there a need for it? Because even the government has, has spoken about it. It is said that during the time of COVID-19, when we are going through such a tough and rough phase, the least that we can do is ensure that we bring about some kind of physical distancing even in our prisons. So what is the status like and what kind of reforms do we need?
See, the condition of prisons in the country is not very good. Let me tell you very frankly, most of the prisons are overcrowded. There are no proper toilets. There are no proper living conditions. It is terrible. In fact, if you and I have to go to prison, let me tell you, it is a horrible experience. And I'm not only talking from my experience in Jammu and Kashmir, but rest of the country. I think the conditions are by far the same all across the country. And I had the privilege of working as Director General of Prisons in JNK before taking over as DGP of the state. And during that period, I attended a conference in international conference on prison in Sri Lanka. Some of our neighboring countries have gone much ahead. Prisons, let me first cover the point you asked, why prison reforms are important, and why the prisons are important in our society. See, the prisons are a very important part of the criminal justice system. I think one of the important part of the criminal justice system, and overall criminal justice system needs a lot of changes from what British had introduced. Unfortunately, this whole criminal justice system, including prisons, have suffered in last 70 years plus at the hands of the state governments, and I would say even union government has neglected it, though prisons and police are in the state list. They are not in the central list. But the kind of neglect the state governments have given to prisons is evident from the condition of the prisons. See, most of the prisons do not have basic facilities like clean water. Look at the Western countries. Look at the condition of prisons. You can have your own food of your choice. You can have your clean room to live in. You can have minus your liberty of going out. There's so much better living condition in the prisons than what is in India. And let me make it very clear, if I think that I will never go to prison, I am mistaken. You know, in this society, any one of us could land in prison. And this is, I want to appeal to the political class and bureaucratic class who actually take all the decisions about prisons. Let them first think that if they have one day to go to prison, what kind of prison they would like to be in. So that is how important prison is. Ultimately, you see, whoever goes to the prison one day comes out to the society, and that period spent in the prison, actually he brings with him the vices or whatever he has picked up in the prison to the society, and that affects the society in the larger picture.
Absolutely. Before Mughal, let me bring you into the picture now. You know, very well said there by a person who's dealt with this on the ground level. You know, you have been working on this issue as well and looking for it at a distance and working at it from very close quarters as well, looking at exactly what's happening and how prisoners are dealt with. What are the biggest challenges, do you think, and why is it that we are so reluctant really to bring about some kind of reforms when we look at prisons? Basic, you know, just some basic necessities need to be given. Even that is lacking.
No, absolutely. Now, what we are seeing is extremely kind of, it's a cause for worry. My point is that if you look at the way the prisons were, say, about 10 years ago, and then 5 years ago, and then today, you actually see that not only there has not been an improvement, there has been actually a deterioration. And it's like a cause for concern, because you realize that in a country like India, we believe that probably we don't have enough resources. So over time, maybe once we have better resources, we will improve our things. But the point is that something extremely unprofessional is going on here. And it's not, as Mr. Ved said, anybody can go to the prison. I believe that today the environment is such that you can go to prison by talking about prison reforms. If you say too much about, you know, why the criminal justice system is working only for the elected representatives and not for the public, then probably you can land up in jail. So I would like to land up in a jail which treats me like a human being. You know, see, look at it from any side, you know. You see from the side of what kind of health and hygiene risks are there in the jails. You know, the life expectancy becomes lower when you land up in a jail. There's prevalence of all kinds of serious diseases. There is HIV there. There is TB is like so rampant that one would be surprised if you go to jail for a prolonged period of time and you come back without TB. You know, there is hepatitis B and C, and there is no way of detecting it. When you ask what kind of doctors are there any doctors or not? You know, the model police, the jail manual says that there should be a doctor at all the time. There should be a doctor for 300 inmates. But even if you don't have that for 300 inmates, you should always have a doctor. But it's not there. In state after state, we see, we bring out a report. It's a collaborative report. Many organizations together bring it out. And we see that, you know, prison after prison, there is no correctional staff. There is no doctor. You know, the staff to inmate ratio is like completely skewed. It is not humanly possible to look at anything in a scientific way. You know, for instance, you need correctional staff for a certain number of inmates, you know, say 30, 40, 50. There are some places, a state like Uttar Pradesh, where there is one correctional staff for 95,000 people. I mean, how on earth can a correctional staff even begin to do his or her work? You know, so there is lack of diversity. The posts are not being filled. The place is filthy. The money is not being invested. Whatever is allocated for investment is not reaching there. So the prisons are a microcosm of what is wrong in the criminal justice system of India.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Mr. Ved, how do we change this? Where does the change need to come from? You know, because nothing has been done. And like Mr. Mudgal also just pointed out, it only seems to have deteriorated over the last one, over the years and not improved. How do we reverse this trend?
I completely agree with Mr. Mudgal. In fact, you would be very lucky if you can escape without an infection from a prison. And I think the punishment is more of a putting you in an inhuman condition than putting you, actually giving you punishment. And let me tell you, everything is ailing in prison. The things are so bad. I have actually dealt it both as the Director General of Prison as well as Mr. Mudgal mentioned of jail manual, model jail manual. I was director in the BPR, in the Bureau of Police Research and Development, and our research being in BPR&D handles with, that is the only organization which remotely handles prisons. I am mentioning remotely, it has a meaning. It doesn't have direct bearing on the prisons. It has only recommendatory powers. And this model prison manual was made in BPR&D and circulated to the states to implement. But tragedy is, you have only adopted it. You have not actually implemented suggestions which were given by the model prison manual. You see, the ailing is you do not have any agency which is actually dealing with the recruitment of prison staff. Some states do not have a proper recruitment policy. In some states, only wardens are recruited. Some states, the inspectors and some states, gusted level recruitment is there of assistant students of prisons. Pan India, there is no training policy. Let me tell you, the condition of prison training is horrible. And unlike police fortunately have a lot of infrastructure for training. You have national training institutions, you have regional training institutions, you have state training institution. Almost every state has its own training institution. That is not true of prisons. Prisons, unfortunately, at the whole country level, there are 3 or 4 regional level training centers, which are also not properly constituted and funded institutions. They are, I visited one of the training institute in South India. That is an institute where training is imparted to the prison staff coming from four or five South Indian states, which is contributory it is run from the contribution of the 4 or 5 southern states. That is not the way you run. You do not have proper budgeting. You do not have proper training manual. You do not have a training syllabus. Not one thing is ailing. Actually, you need to go whole hog. You have, I went to Sri Lanka, as I mentioned earlier. You have a concept there of an open prison. In the open prison, why can't it be done in India? And such a beautiful concept. I could see prisoners actually growing vegetables and doing agriculture. What a way of giving them relaxation. Mr. Mudgal mentioned like correctional services staff. We do not pay much attention towards that. You need to give them, in fact, various kinds of training so that once they come out of the prison, they have some a skill acquired so that they can live an honorable life. So all these issues need to be addressed. I think a holistic approach is required to address the prison reforms.
Absolutely. I think I'll take, let me take this particular point forward. It's an interesting point. You know, when you're talking about prison reforms, it is also about reforming a person that you send to prison, and that's why the person is sent to prison. But if the conditions do not allow a person to be reformed and only makes him worse or makes him into a worse person of what he was earlier before he went to prison, I mean, how do you change that? What needs to be done there, Vipul Murugan?
I think there are, that's, I think, a very higher level of things. I think once, if, I think we have to start by talking about things which are very, very basic. The most basic thing is to treat a human being like a human being. And later, it comes to, you know, what you want him to go out as. You, he or she comes as a, supposedly as an alleged criminal and goes back perhaps a slightly reformed person. But, you know, that I think is a second or third level of things. The first and foremost is that are you treating people who are inside prisons as human beings? You know, and there have been no dearth of committees formed. Many committees are formed. There are very good manuals and very good rules. In fact, some of the acts around the jail system are very good. One of them is that the district judge has to make a visit to the prison once in a month. You know, even the high court judges are mandated to go to the prison once in a while. There is a system for it. You know, so if there is an inspection, and if the people who are going for inspection are supposed to do certain things, that you will do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You will check whether these facilities are there. You will check whether it meets certain criteria or not. As Mr. Ved said in the beginning of when he started, that, you know, it's a part of the overall criminal justice system. And we have to see, you just can't change one cog. You know, I see that there are two or three things which are very, very clearly and very, very intricately linked. These are the police, the prisons, the judiciary, and the legal aid. You know, when a person goes to the jail, or when a person is arrested as an accused, you know, that person is entitled to a lawyer, is entitled under Indian laws to have an advocate of his choice, can get a lawyer, and it is the duty of the police who arrest him to give him the right lawyer. His lawyer can go and meet him. You know, you see what is going on in Bhima Koregaon case. You know, you have a large number of intellectuals who have been incarcerated, and every time when it comes to filing a charge sheet, some technicality is brought up in such a way that you bring up a supplementary charge sheet and you earn another 180 days. And, you know, there is a limit. Let us assume that they are all guilty. Then what does the Indian law say? The Indian law says that in a certain number of days, 90 days, you have to charge sheet them. You know, say if it is a very serious case under UAPA, etc., I mean, it is highly questionable what kind of acts have been used. But if it is a questionable case, then 180 days, for God's sake, give them a charge sheet. Tell them why are they there. You know, in fact, this is a high profile case. Let me tell you, a very large number of people inside the jail do not know why they are there. You know, there are cases of mistaken identity. One man of the same name has been arrested from a village because they could not find another man with the same name where the name of the father is different. You know, and it takes a whole lifetime to prove. So when you have correctional staff, when you have a system of feedback, when people are asked certain things, you know, when people are treated as human beings, when the law applies to them, you know, the worst thing which is happening in the Indian prisons is that Indian constitution as if stops outside the gate of the prison. It does not go inside. I think the moment we start treating them as human beings, you know, I think a lot will change. And as part of the criminal justice system, if all these things, you know, become a part of a continuum, and we start seeing that how, you know, a lot of things need to apply. Say, what kind of diversity you need in the staff? What kind of vacancies are allowed? There are some places where 75% vacancies are there. No, sir, this is not allowed. You can't have more than 10% vacancies. You know, and you know, what is the complexion of that staff? How is the budget being spent, etc., etc.? So I think there is a 360 degree correction which is required.
Absolutely. Time now to get quick closing comments from all my panelists with the best way forward. Starting first with you, Mr. Ved.
See, there are very good, as Mr. Mudgal said, very good laws, Indian laws on paper, very good. And some of the court judgments are outstanding. Like the order of the, I think it's an order of the Honorable Supreme Court, that in each jail, the district judge and the district magistrate and the district superintendent of police, all three of them should visit once in a month. Very good concept. But does it happen on the ground? And is it getting desired impact? Are you high court judge in his jurisdiction can visit any prison? These are some of the very lofty ideas. But on ground, it should have an impact. You have very good concept of parole in the prisons. Leave the person, let him live for some time with his family and then come back. As I mentioned of the open prisons, you have some of the officers at their individual levels introduce very good concepts like yoga, meditation for the welfare of the well-being of the inmates, even vocational training. The concept of distance learning. You can earn degrees. Some of them aren't even postgraduate and graduate degrees while being in prison. Last point I would like to mention here, but we must have separate way of dealing with high profile. That is because I'm mentioning this because I have worked as DGP of the J&K. Something is seriously wrong in prisons in Kashmir Valley. So when you are dealing with high profile terrorists, hardcore terrorists, you need to have isolation chambers, you need to have high security prisons, you need to prevent mixing of stone pelters with the terrorist, because what we saw in Kashmir, many stone pelters while interacting with the terrorists in the prison became actually the terrorists, and they became the recruiting grounds, they became radicalized. So such situation should be prevented. Many prisons, I have seen this happening in Kashmir, have become centers, particularly the prison in Srinagar city has become a center of planning and executing terrorist attack. Now that condition should be such that this thing should not happen. Otherwise, right, the whole concept of the criminal justice system or prison is defeated. So we should, while reforming prisons, we should take care of this. So I wanted to mention this as my last remark.
Absolutely. And Vipul Mudgal, close the show for us with your concluding remarks.
I believe that this is a part of this is reflected in all prisons, sir. You know, you see a lot of smaller criminals who come to the jail, they go back as hardened criminals because they come in contact with. And I think training here is very important. If the staff is unprofessional, if they are not trained properly, or if people who have no business being there are there, you know, a lot of things, undesirable things happen. It becomes a den of undesirable activities. Or if some people are given preferential treatment, there are places in Uttar Pradesh where the politicians, the so-called criminal politicians who are inside, they run their own gyms. Yeah. They have their cell phones, etc. I think the first and foremost here is that the under trials, as Mr. Ved said, that you differentiate between convicts and under trials, you know, people who are facing serious charges of offenses in more than, you know, which attract sentence for more than 5 years or 7 years, with those who are there who don't even know why they are there. So the under trials, 2/3 of them are under trials. So if you give them, and believe me, a very large number of under trials are there for very small offenses. For instance, if you are caught for traffic challan twice or thrice, and if you don't fill your challan money, then it becomes a criminal offense. It gets compounded and you go to jail. So if there is a small purse, with the state government or with some NGOs and whoever, and if they can bail out people who are there for absolutely insignificant smaller offenses, then those people have no business being inside the jail. They you can try them, but they can be outside. And a large number of people, who have not been served charge sheets, etc., should not be inside the jails. So I think one, you treat the under trials differently from convicts and others, and two, you have all the facilities and all the systems of the police or of the prison staff, like the proper training, like the proper staffing, like the diversity. There should be enough number of women there. There should be, the diversity in terms of, it should reflect the diversity of India's society. If we have SC, ST, OBCs, minorities, it should be reflected in the prison staff. If they all come from one caste or community, there is some problem here. So, I think we have to, as I said, you need 360 degree reforms. And the biggest worry for me is that I do not see improvement over the years. We did in India Justice Report, we looked at the prisons of 29 states and union territories between 2011 and 2016. There is improvement in only 3 or 4 states. Rest of the states are either stagnating or deteriorating.
Absolutely. All right. That's a very sad and sorry state of affairs, but that's how it is. We hope that it will change sometime in the near future. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining me on the program and putting things into perspective for us. What's coming out of this discussion is that prison reforms, like many others, is really the need of the hour. Over the years, instead of progressing, we have only regressed with regards to the state of prisons. The prisoners too need to have humane living conditions. Let's not forget, most of those who are in prison are under trials and not hardened criminals. We also have to make a distinction between the various types of prisoners and keep them away from each other so that true reform takes place of the prisoners as well. Once again, thank you for your continued support. For those of you who haven't already subscribed, please like the video, subscribe, hit the bell icon, and then all notifications. Do follow our social media handles for all the latest updates, and you can also subscribe to our newsletter to get some incisive content. The Bharata First team runs a daily Big Picture quiz. Please do participate by going through the description in the Big Picture videos. Here are the UPI IDs for those of you who would like to come forward and contribute. A small contribution that you make will be a giant leap for us to keep bringing you this content. So do continue to show your love and support. All the information is in the description of the video, along with further video recommendations as well. So please go through the description. That's it from me. See you again next time.